Good morning. I am Dr. Rajendra Prasad. I am a director of medical education, ERAS Lucknow Medical College and Hospital, Lucknow. I have been former director, Vallabhbhai Patel Chest Institute, Delhi, and I have been former professor and head, Department of Pulmonary Medicine, KGMC, Lucknow. Today, I will be starting a new series on the chest X-rays. What I plan that the first lecture would be how to interpret normal chest X-rays, which I think every clinician, whether he is a physician, whether he is a surgeon, whether he is a specialist, whether he is a super specialist, in their lifetime has to see the chest X-ray and has to react to the chest X-ray. So, first lecture would be pertaining to this. Subsequently, there would be many lectures regarding the chest X-ray. The another lecture I am planning that what is the differential diagnosis of normal looking chest X-ray. What do I mean that if X-ray looks normal in the first look, but patient has symptoms, how I diagnose those patients in my 40 years of career, I will share with you in my next lecture. And the subsequent lectures will be sharing you the important chest X-rays as a clinical pearls in pulmonary medicine. So, as a part of the first lecture, that is how to approach a chest X-ray. As I have said earlier, that every clinician has to see the chest X-ray in his lifetime. When chest X-ray comes to you, your objective always remains in mind whether X-ray is normal or abnormal. That is the question number one. The second question comes to our mind, if it is abnormal, then what is the abnormality? So these three questions are always, whenever you look on any chest X-rays, are in back of our mind. Now to answer these three questions, you have to see the X-ray. And to see the X-ray, there are two approaches. One is systematic approach and another is global approach. When I say systematic approach, in the systematic approach, what you have to do, you have to see every part of the X-ray in a systemic manner, should not miss any finding whatever is looking in the X-ray. And the another approach is global approach. When I say global, it means you have to see first what is the abnormality. Suppose there is a rounded side in the chest X-ray, so your mind will always go to those rounded shadows. In a global approach, you have to first see the abnormality and then you have to go to the periphery of the X-ray. When I say periphery the X-ray, other points, whatever is visible in the X-ray, you have to see and then you have to combine all the findings to the, whether you look systematically, whether you look globally, you have to combine all the findings before you can come out with diagnosis or differential diagnosis. I always teach my students, whether UG or PG, when you see the X-ray for first 10 years as a clinician, you must have a systemic look. Systemic looks means you have to develop a system and every time you have to see the X-ray, you have to go through that system. And then combine all the findings together and then think about diagnosis or differential diagnosis. About the systemic way of seeing the X-ray, I will tell you one system. You may develop your own system, but only rider with systemic approach is, you have to see each and everything visible in the chest X-ray systematically. And global approach, of course, as I have told you, that you have to see the abnormality, whatever abnormality is there in the chest X-ray first, and then you have to go to other findings in the chest X-ray, then you have to combine, and then you have to construct a diagnosis or differential diagnosis. What I always suggest that beginners should not have a global approach, because if you have a global approach, you will just concentrate on the main shadow and you may miss so many findings which are present in the chest X-ray, and you are likely to misclassify or misdiagnose. So for first 10 years, you should have a systematic approach, and then when you become little experienced, then you may afford to have a global approach. Now, when I say systematic approach, in systematic approach, you have to look for certain technical points and then certain anatomical points. Now, what are the technical points which you usually look when we see the chest X-ray? In the technical points, we just see which side of the X, whether it is the right side, so determination of the side, which one is right and which one is left, and then whether it is a plane or contrast X-ray, which view is this X-ray, then you have to talk about rotation if it is present. Ideally, well done X-rays, patient may not be rotated, but most of the situation we find, patient has rotated on one side, so you have to note it down. And then you have to think about exposure, and then you have to think that whether the film has been done in inspiratory phase or expiratory phase. Ideally, chest X-rays are done in full inspiration, but what we have seen, sometimes patient doesn't take the full inspiration and X-ray are taken in expiration. So that X-ray also you have to comment on that. So as far as anatomical points are concerned, you have to develop again a system as for whatever is visible in chest X-ray. You may start from soft tissue, you may go to the bony case, you may go to the trachea, you may go to the diaphragm, then you can see the heart, you can see the hilum, you can see the mediastinum, you can see the fissures if it is visible, and then finally you have to see the lung parenchyma. So you have seen the main difference. When you see the X-ray globally, you probably, since it is a chest X-ray, you have to see the lung parenchyma first. But when you see the X-ray systematically, what is the main difference? That you have to see the lung parenchyma at the end. Let us start with technical points. How the side is decided? You know, the certain landmarks on the left side are, there is a fundal gas shadow on the left side, apex of the heart lies on the left side, and aortic knuckle is also present on the left side. So by these three landmarks, you can recognize that this is the left side of the chest X-ray and this is the right side of the chest X-ray. But many times these landmark may not be visible, then what we say even today, the sacrosanct is the marker which is put by the technician while taking the chest X-rays. So in scenario of difficulty, when these landmarks may not be clearly visible, you can see the marker put on the X-ray, whether it is a left or right. So this is the first point in a technical issues you see. Then you see that whether the X-ray has been done, whether it is a plain X-ray, a contrast X-ray, Sometimes, most of the time you see the plain X-ray, but sometimes you may see bronchography, barium swallow, sometimes angiography can come to you and you have to comment. And then you have to see the which view you are observing. Most common view for chest X-rays are the PA view, and sometimes when patient may not be able to position, patient may not be able to stand, then sometimes AP view is done. AP view is done in the lying view, and then lateral views are done, and after lateral view, another view what we call is as lordotic view, sometimes lordotic view is done. So these are the views when these are done. So you have to comment whether chest X-ray, PA view, plane or contrast or chest X-ray, other views you have to comment like this. One another view which is done is the lateral decubitus view. So I will tell you the indication subsequently. But PA and AP view, as I said, that PA view is done standard chest X-ray, done in most of the cases. But sometimes AP view is done, especially in a very sick patient, when you want to see the spine very clearly, or sometimes in infants, you have to do for the AP views. Now, you have to differentiate between PA view and AP view, and some of the major points of differentiation could be that clavicle in PA view is as shaped, and it looks straight or broken in AP view. Ribs are obliquely placed in PA view and it is horizontally placed in AP view. Upper four vertebral bodies are visible in PA view and all the vertebras are visible in AP views. Heart is well defined and normal in size, less well defined, maybe more in size. Scapula usually out of field in PA view, and in AP view it is inside the field because you cannot position the patient. Diaphragm is at fifth or sixth intercostal space, and in AP view it is elevated. Bronchovascular markings in PA view, more at the lower zones, less at the mid zone and none at the upper zone, and in it is equally distributed in AP view. Fundal gas shadow is present on the left side, it is absent on AP view, and parenchyma is well defined in PA view, less well defined in AP view, and as I said, PA view is most commonly. So by this you can see that whether X-ray is done in PA view or AP view. Lateral view are very common view sometimes we look for. And lateral view is indicated for lobar or segmental localization. If you find retrocardiac shadow, which may not be visible in PA view, localization of the incisive effusion, localization of the mediastinal lesions, and sometimes you have to look the oblique fissure, you have to see, you have to go for the lateral views. So that are the indication of the lateral views. Oblique view are very rarely taken, but sometimes localize the lesion when this is a bilateral, lower lobe involvement, tracheal bifurcation, visualize structure hidden by the heart or bony case, left atrium and cardiac chambers, and sometimes nowadays bronchography is not done, but you do sometimes bilateral bronchography, oblique view is preferred. Another view is a lateral decubitus view, I told you. Lateral decubitus view, when patient lies down on one lateral side, and this view is indicated for infrapulmonary effusion, small pleural effusion, small pneumothorax, or if you want to localize the extent of cavity, you may go for the lateral decubitus view. And next view is lordotic view. Lordotic view is the as you stand like a lord, or else the X-ray tube is tilted 45 degree downwards, then it becomes lordotic view. In a lordotic view, the clavicle goes out of the field, and there are only two indications. And one thing I would like to caution, that when you look for the Lord Arctic view for which indication you have ordered Lord Arctic view, only those areas should be looked upon. Like indications, sometimes you suspect some shadow in the retroclavicular area of lung, which might be hidden behind the clavicle, behind the ribs, then you can order Lord Arctic view, you can find those shadows. And second indication for Lord Arctic view is the middle lobe collapse. Middle lobe collapse, if it is real collapse, it is usually not visible in PA view, neither on the lateral view, but it is visible in the Lord Arctic view. In the technical points, as I said, you have to look for rotation. And to look for the rotation, you have to draw a midline from the mid-sternal point, from the vertebra, and then you see the medial end of clavicle. Where distance is more, suppose distance is more on the right side, then you can comment that there is a left anterior oblique rotation. So, if the distance is more on the right side, so you can say there is a left anterior oblique rotation. And in why it is important to comment upon the rotation? Because in rotation, if a patient may be normal, X-ray may be normal, but certain abnormalities you may find because of the rotation. Of course, they will not be present in the clinical examination, like heart and trachea will be shifted to opposite side. Posterior structure shifted to the same side, diaphragm raised on the same side, hilar prominence will be there on the same side, and lung fields may look hyperlucent on the opposite side. Why it is important for clinician? Because some of the findings, if it is present, it may be because of rotation, then you will not misclassify these patients. Then the another technical points, when we always see the X-ray, we see whether X-ray is overexposed, normally exposed or underexposed. In a normal exposed films, the upper four intervertebral spaces are usually visible, and in overexposed films, it is more all the four vertebrae may be visible. So, sometimes the overexposed films are indicated because if you want to visualize mediastinum structure behind the heart, domes of the diaphragm, trachea, main bronchi, thoracic spine, small lung nodules, mediastinal pleural reflection. So, all these things probably will be visible in overexposed films, but usually it should be the adequate exposed film which you have to comment. And then you have to find out whether the film has been done on inspiratory phase or expiratory phase. Usually I said the chest X-ray is taken in full inspiration, but sometimes patient is not able to take breath properly, or sometimes X-ray is taken very hurriedly and patient not able to breathe properly. So, this expiratory film, how you recognize expiratory films? Expiratory films, you may find that both the domes of the diaphragms will be at higher level, and then there could be apparent cardiomegaly. Cardiomegaly will not be there, in fact, but it looks in X-ray, it appears that there is apparent cardiomegaly, haziness on lung bases may be visible. So, if you say from beginning that film is done on expiratory phase, such type of film usually are not red, but because these abnormalities you have to keep in mind. But in certain situation, an expiratory films may be indicated. If you want to see the unilateral obstructive emphysema, small pneumothorax, early interstitial disease, intrapulmonary effusion, differentiate vascular from solid or cystic lesion, sometimes expiratory films are indicated. So, what we see in the technical points, ultimately we know that what is the quality of film. If the person, suppose, is scapulized within the field, patient is grossly rotated, film has been done on a full expiration, then probably such type of films are not of good quality, and I always say that such type of films should not be read. Here I would like to quote you one of the study when we have studied while I was in KGMC, that disparity between chest X-ray reporting and actual diagnosis. What we did when patient comes with chest X-ray, we just examine the patient and chest X-ray, and we just saw the report, what is reported by the radiologist and what is actually present in the patient. Out of 284 chest X-ray we analyzed, 192, that is about 67% patient, had one or another quality problem. Poor quality films, what I say, is very common when we see the X-rays, and clinician has to discount those poor quality issues, and if it is very poor quality, I always say that throw into dustbin, don't read such type of X-rays, otherwise you are likely to misdiagnose and misclassify such type of X-rays. Now, after the technical points, we go to the anatomical points. And as I said that, I have told you a system of seeing the anatomical point, starting from soft tissue to bony case, to trachea, to diaphragm, to heart, to hilum, mediastinum, fissures, and finally, lung parenchyma is seen. Now, soft tissue shadow, you may look for sometimes one breast is absent, sometimes nipple shadows are visible, maybe unilaterally or bilaterally. Sometimes pleats of hair can be visible on the chest X-ray. Companion shadows may be visible. Sometimes you may find subcutaneous calcification, you may find subcutaneous air, what we call. So you have to be very careful. Sometimes you may find some swelling in the soft tissue, which is visible. So, taking all these consideration, if something is visible and if you combine together, then you are making, suppose you find one of the breast is absent in one of the chest X-rays and patient presented with some nodular shadows. So, you may very clearly say that lady might have got CA breast, mastectomy has been done, that's why one breast is absent, and now she has developed secondaries. So, it is very easy. If you read the X-ray systematically, it becomes very easy to read. Like that, you may see pleats of hair. Sometimes we may confuse with the shadows and you may diagnose with the tuberculosis. I will share one of the X-rays where somebody has diagnosed as tuberculosis, and when we remove those hairs, we find shadows had disappeared, and so we said it is not because of the lung lesion, but because of the extrathoracic shadow. In extrathoracic shadow, I always try to implement, if something you can trace it from the outside, you may say that this shadow is coming from outside the chest. Like pleat of hairs, you may clearly show that this is coming from outside the chest. So, if source you can demonstrate that it is from outside of chest, most probably there could be an extrathoracic shadow. After the soft tissue, you may go to read to the bony case. In a bony case, you look clavicles, you look all the ribs together, anterior end and posterior end, you look intercostal spaces and spines. Now, clavicles, what I am trying to say, that clavicle, you try to recognize the first rib. Rule says that the first anterior end just below the clavicle is the first rib. And if you find any anterior end above it, as a rule, it will become a cervical rib. After that, you count the ribs, first two ribs anteriorly, and then go on to posteriorly to count them. So, like every rib is seen, anterior end and posterior end. Clavicle is seen, ribs are seen, intercostal spaces are seen, whether they are widened, they are same, whether they are narrowed, and then finally, if some part of the spines are visible, you have also to see the spines. That is how you read bony case. Here you see a X-ray which has cervical rib. As you can see, the first above first rib, there is an anterior end on the left side, so it becomes unilateral cervical rib. Here in this X-ray, you may find bilateral cervical ribs. Now, cervical rib may be symptomatic depending upon the patient to patient. You may find out a bifid rib. Here you see that the one rib is bifid on the right side. And then bony case abnormality, you may find, like I have already told you, cervical rib, bifid rib. You may find fractures in rib. Around the fractures, there may be callus formation. I have seen that many patients are misdiagnosed with, because of callus formation, as tuberculosis and given anti-TB drugs. You may find punched out areas. You may find erosion of ribs. You may find destruction of ribs. You may find rib notching. So all these things are possible in while you read a bony case systematically. I see one of the cases of punched out areas, many times diagnosis is multiple myeloma and osteolytic secondaries. So you see in this X-ray on the clavicle, you may find punched out area, and finally you may find punched out area in the skull also, and the lady was diagnosed as multiple myeloma. Erosion of ribs may be because of the developmental error like fibrous dysplasia, benign tumors like chondroma, osteochondroma, or cyst, malignant tumors like sarcoma, metastasis. Sometimes erosion of ribs may be present in tuberculosis also, empyema necessitans, and osteomyelitis. First, you report those findings, and so not that every time erosion means malignancy, sometimes benign lesion, sometimes tuberculosis can also cause erosion of the ribs. As you see in this X-ray, she has shadow on the right upper zone peripheral portion, and one of the ribs has been eroded, and that is clearly shown that this is a malignant, and she was finally diagnosed as adenocarcinoma. Here in this case, you find posterior end of multiple ribs lower down is missing, and you find some shadow, you find bulging on the soft tissue, and this patient was diagnosed as sarcoma. Then after seeing the soft tissue and bony case, you go to examine diaphragm. And in diaphragm is examined under four headings: what is the position of diaphragm, what is the shape of diaphragm, how the costophrenic and cardiophrenic angles, and look for gas under the diaphragm. Now, as far as position of the diaphragm, it may be normal, it may be raised, unilateral, bilateral, or it may be depressed. In a normal chest X-ray, right side of the dome of the diaphragm is between 5th rib to 6th and half intercostal spaces, depending upon how much patient has taken the breathing in. Usually, right side is higher than the left side in about 90% of the individual. Left may be at the same or at the higher level in maybe 5 to 9% of the individual, and right side sometimes there is more than 3 centimeter higher than the left, rarely seen in 1 to 2% of the individual. What I am saying, these are the normal. So we should be aware that normal level of the diaphragms even may vary in some of the patients, and they may be normal. And you see that here the right dome of diaphragm is higher than the left. Left may be sometimes at the same level, and normally in normal patients, and sometimes even higher than the right side. And usually the bilateral raised dome of diaphragm, when we find, we usually react that either it is the abdominal cause, or sometimes when disease is bilateral like fibrosing alveolitis, in infants, both the domes of diaphragm may be, and else when the film is done in full expiration, it is expiratory film, domes of diaphragm, both the domes of diaphragm will rise. This is one of the film of Rama Devi, when you see that both the diaphragms are at higher level, and it is because of the expiratory film. Then here, because of the gas shadow below domes of the diaphragm, here the pneumoperitoneum was done, so the domes of diaphragm are higher. Unilateral raised diaphragm invites five differential diagnoses, and if it is not normally, One is paralytic, means neuroparalysis, something like a phrenic nerve is involved in the process, starting from spinal cord to neck to mediastinum, anywhere in the course, if there is a involvement of phrenic nerve, one of the diaphragm may be raised. Mechanical causes like fibrosis, like collapse, may raise the diaphragm. Then developmental causes like eventration of the diaphragm, which is present on the left side, and spastic means something below the diaphragm, like subphrenic abscess, like liver abscess, may raise the diaphragm and fix the position there, until unless you treat them. And this is, you find here in this X-ray, the left dome of diaphragm is higher up, and then you find in the mediastinum, there is a mediastinal widening, so probably it is involvement of phrenic nerve that has raised the left dome of diaphragm. Here is the gentleman who, in previously, very, very long back, he went for phrenic crush. One of the mode of treatment of tuberculosis, right dome of diaphragm is higher up. And here in this patient, you find that right dome of the diaphragm is higher up. It is because of the spastic, there was a liver abscess which was drained. In the next X-ray, you may find the gas below the right dome of diaphragm, which is not usually present. It was iatrogenic, when some, while doing aspiration, some gas might have been introduced. So this is one of the reasons for spastic causes of the, as I said, eventration of diaphragm is congenital condition, and it is present left-sided. So you see that left dome of diaphragm is very thin and very high up, and this is a congenital. If you have previous X-ray, you compare, since it is a congenital condition, that will diagnose eventration of the diaphragm. So depressed diaphragm usually is seen bilaterally in chronic obstructive emphysema, tension air cyst of the lung, acute obstructive emphysema, it may be unilateral, massive pleural effusion, both the diaphragms may be, if it is diaphragms may be depressed, or tension pneumothorax, diaphragms may be depressed. This is some of the example of pneumothorax, tension pneumothorax on the right side. So you see the dome of the diaphragm is depressed. Here it is COPD, where both the diaphragms are depressed. Sometimes localized eventration is also seen on the right side of the diaphragm. So after reading about the safe positions, and then you find what is the costophrenic angle like and what is a cardiophrenic angle like. Costophrenic angle, they are obliterated. Most common causes are pleural effusion, pleural thickening, COPD. Sometimes you see both costophrenic angles are obliterated. Many people do confuse with pleural effusion. Lower lobe consolidation or lower lobe collapse, it may be obliterated. In case of, here you see the case of unilateral and bilateral small effusions, when both the costophrenic angles are obliterated. And then you, here you see a case of a COPD, overinflated chest, where diaphragms are depressed both and the costophrenic angles are obliterated. Because when diaphragm goes down, the costophrenic muscle slips, they come into the costophrenic angle and they obliterate. This is not pleural effusion, this is a COPD. Cardiophrenic angles, when you look, and they can, usually they are normal, but when they are obliterated, you may think of conditions like collapse of middle or lower lobe or lingular segment of the left upper lobe. You may find in hiatus hernia, pleuropericardial cyst, pericardial pad of fat, and prominent inferior vena cava. So these are the, if you find that cardiophrenic angle is obliterated, you may search out of these causes. And as you see here is a one case where left cardiophrenic angle is appears to be obliterated, and this was the pneumonia of the lingular segment of the left upper lobe. This is where you find that the gas under the right dome of diaphragm is because somebody has introduced in liver, while draining liver abscess. This is because of pneumoperitoneum, and this is an example of Chiliaditi syndrome, where you find on the right dome of diaphragm there is a gas. Then you have to look for trachea. After the diaphragm you have seen, you have looked for trachea. trachea may be shifted to the same side of lesion, may be shifted to the opposite side of lesion. Before commenting upon the trachea, you must look over the rotation. As you see in this person, the patient is rotated onto left anterior oblique rotation. So, trachea appears to be shifted on right side. In fact, patient was normal, and when we examine him, trachea was not shifted, and this was because of the rotation. And shifting on the same side may be because of the congenital conditions like agenesis, hypoplasia, fibrosis and collapse of the one lung, and sometimes post-operative pneumonectomy or thoracoplasty. All these can shift to trachea on the trachea shift on opposite side. Usually you may find either the massive pleural effusion or tension pneumothorax. Then there are some very large mediastinal tumor or space occupying lesion, then trachea may be shifted to the opposite side. Here you see a massive pleural effusion where trachea is shifted to the opposite side. Then after commenting upon the trachea, you should comment upon the heart. Heart is, you see about the position of the heart, borders of the heart, size of the heart and shape of the heart. So, under four headings: position, border, size and shape. Position of the heart, usually 2/3 on the left and 1/3 on the right side of the spine. This is present in about 88% to 90%. Sometimes half on the left side and half on the right side of the spine. This is not very common, seen in 7%. Left side is more than 2/3 of spine, seen in 4.8%, and right is more than left is 0.2%. So, what I am trying to say, not every time heart looks normally, sometimes in normal patients there may be little variation. And usually left border of heart is found by left ventricle, left atrial appendages, pulmonary conus, aortic knuckle, and right side is found by right atrium and superior vena cava. Size of the heart, you have to comment. There are three methods to comment upon the size of the heart. One is cardiothoracic ratio, means when cardiothoracic ratio, you measure the maximum diameter of the thorax and maximum diameter of the heart, and if it is less than, ratio is less than 50%, normally it is less than 50%. If it is more than 50%, it means there is a cardiomegaly, provided film is done in full inspiration. Another way of see the change in the heart, if the transverse diameter of the heart is more than 15.5 cm, you can straight say that there is a cardiomegaly. And then the difference between two identical X-rays, not that one is expiratory, one is inspiratory, two identical films, difference is 1.5 cm. If difference is more than this, you can say that yes, there has been change in the size of the heart. But one prerequisite, very important prerequisite, commenting upon the size of the heart, it should be PA view in full inspiration or with no rotation and with no scoliosis. Then you can comment on the heart size. Here I have shown you in a diagram, you have to measure the maximum size of the chest by drawing a line, the highest point of the diaphragm on the right side, and then you have to measure the maximum diameter of the heart the way it is shown in the picture, and then divide. Here the cardiothoracic ratio is more than 0.54, more than 5, so there is a cardiomegaly. It looks also there is a cardiomegaly. And here you find in X-ray where maximum cardiac diameter was 8.6, and in the next film, identical film, it has gone to 12.5. So, more cardiac size has increased, more than 1.5 cm, so definitely you may say that cardiac size has increased. Then you have to depend, sometimes you comment upon the shape of chest. Pendular shape is usually seen in emphysema, long thin chest, good separate chest is seen in Fallot's tetralogy, you can see mitralization, you can see different shape in carpal nail. So, this is the normal chest X-ray, and this is a pendular, this is a COPD case, and this is the cardiomegaly, as in case of mitral stenosis. So you may, when you see these, when you really read x-rays systematically, you may finding these. Suppose somebody, this patient I still remember, came to me with recurrent hemoptysis. I just saw the x-ray, I find it's like a mitralization. Pulmonary conus is very prominent. I just put my stethoscope over the mitral area, I find him is mid-diastolic murmur. I just send the patient to cardiologist because he was a diagnosed case of mitral stenosis. So what I'm trying to say, many of the cases I have seen, they're misdiagnosed because x-ray are not read systematically. Then you have to look for the hilum. Hilum consists of blood vessel, bronchi, lymph nodes and lymphatics. These are the four structures which hilum consists of. So hilum, how you have to comment? You have to see the size, you have to see the position, you have to see the shape of the hilum, you have to see the radiopacity. All those you have to carefully comment, and you find that this is the normal film. Size of the hilum may be normal, may be enlarged, may be small. When enlarged, it may be unilateral, it may be bilateral. And size of the hilum, what I have to say, that normal size of the hilum, both are equal in 84% of the cases. Right hilum is larger than left hilum in 8%, and sometimes left hilum is larger than right in 8%. So normally right and left are same, but sometimes right or left may be larger in a normal situation. And in large hilum, suppose you see in large hilum, you have to look for rotation first. Then there are lesions, whether there are some enlarged lymph nodes, then there are some pulmonary artery thromboembolism, pulmonary artery aneurysm, and either you get some neoplasm there in bronchial, at bronchus in the hilum, you may get enlarged hilum unilaterally. There you see here example of hilar lymphadenopathy caused tuberculosis. Here you find again a bilateral hilar enlargement caused being sarcoidosis. Bilateral hilar enlargement may be present in expiratory film one, and it may be because of lymph node enlargement, because of tuberculosis, because of sarcoidosis and other lesions. Then you may get pulmonary hypertension, pulmonary embolism, congenital heart disease. You may, when there is a left to right shunt like PDA, VSD, ASD, post-operative fallacetrology, you may find bilateral enlarged hilum. Here you say bilateral enlarged hilum diagnosed as sarcoidosis. Small hilum may be because of the congenital cyanotic heart disease, hypoplasia of the pulmonary artery, pulmonary embolism, neoplasm of the pulmonary artery, lobar collapse, idiopathic unilateral hypertranslucent lung, and because of, it may be because of the rotation and scoliosis. So everything you have to comment. And the position of the hilum, normally left hilum is higher than right, but this is seen only in 97% of the patient. In 3% of the patient, left and right may, hilum may be at the same level, and even sometimes the right hilum may be higher than the left. If right is hilum than the left, it is usually pathological in nature. Radiopacity, if you see the density, the right hilum is equivalent to left hilum in 91%, right hilum is larger than left in 6%, and left hilum is larger than right in 3% of the cases. Congested hilum may be because of emphysema, chronic bronchitis, cardiac causes like mitral stenosis, mitral regurgitation, aortic stenosis, aortic regurgitation, aortic aneurysm, patent ductus arteriosus and patent interventricular septum. So there could be many cardiac reason for the congested hilum. Here you see mediastinal widening, and this is because of the lymph node which has, after treatment, it has disappeared. It was tubercular in etiology. There is another lymph node, it has disappeared. This gentleman has presented with the mediastinal widening, had multiple lymph nodes in the neck and was diagnosed as Hodgkin's lymphoma, and you know, a short of a chemotherapy has dissolved all the lymph nodes. What we say is the lymphoma sometimes melts like ice. So here bilateral mediastinal lymph nodes, here the dome of the diaphragm is also raised left side. It is possibly because of the phrenic nerve involvement. Luckily it was proven as tubercular. Here you again find a multiple mediastinal and hilar lymph nodes. It is because of tuberculosis. You may sometimes, while observing the mediastinum, you may find pneumomediastinum that you may have to comment upon. And finally, when you have seen the mediastinum, so you have started from soft tissue, bony case, trachea, heart, diaphragm, hilum, mediastinum, finally you come to read to the lung. When you read lung parenchyma in chest X-ray, it is not talked like lobes, when it is talked like zones. So as you know, there are three lobes on the right side and two lobes on the left side, but zone wise there are three zones on the right and three zones on the left. And this division is done, as you can see in this X-ray, marking has been done for the upper horizontal line is drawn from anterior end of the second rib, lower border of the second rib, and same landmarks and the fourth rib, you draw another horizontal line. So you may find, thus with these two lines, you divide into upper zone, middle zone and lower zone, and with the help of perpendicular line through midclavicular line, you may divide into these zones into the central portion and the peripheral portion. Like the upper zone is divided with the help of clavicle into supraclavicular, into infraclavicular, and infraclavicular is further divided with this perpendicular line into the paratracheal and peripheral, and the middle zone is further divided into parahilar and peripheral, and lower zone is divided into paracardiac and peripheral. So what is advantage of zones? Because when lung is diseased, the anatomy of lobes changes. So you cannot clearly tell about the lobes. But if you talk in the zones and sub-zones, you may at least say that this shadow is present in this particular area, and that you may invite the differential diagnosis. Here the, see the next X-ray, when which was done, I have shown you this X-ray previously, it was done in expiratory film. Here you can find that only upper and mid part of middle zone is visible, lower zone is not visible. That is why I said when you do a chest X-ray, it is inspiratory, it is not expiratory film. So ladies and gentlemen, I have come to end of my presentation, and what I have to say, that every clinician, whether physician or surgeon, has to read chest X-rays. And when you read the chest X-ray, you may have two approaches, systemic approach and global approach. In systemic approach, you may have technical points, you may have anatomical points. In systemic approach, you look the X-ray systematically, so every point is seen. And in global approach, you look the abnormality first, and then you go to see the other anatomical or technical issues. So what I am trying to say, take home message with this presentation is that you first beginner for 10 years may not try to go for global approach. If you go for global approach, you are likely to commit many mistakes, and if you so have a systemic approach for first 10 years and gain experience, then you can afford to have global approach. Thank you very much.